Okay, good morning everyone. So I received not much but some feedback about yesterday's lecture. So the first feedback is that not only am I doing very bad lectures, but I also brought rain to Florence. So, and apparently I checked the weather forecast, it's gonna be beautiful again as soon as I leave. So, I'm sorry, I will go in history as the, not only as the worst lecturer, but also as the one who brings bad weather with him. So, this guarantees I will not be invited again. And the other feedback I received was that the second part of yesterday's lecture was a bit too fast and too symbolic and too not intuitive. So I will start with a recap of what we did yesterday, and I will spend some time going again through the hidden symmetries so that everyone can catch up. My apologies if you already know the subject very well, and it might be a little bit boring, but I prefer to have everyone on board and not losing anyone in the meantime. If you have questions, please interrupt. Today we don't have any time constraint. We don't have the villa waiting for us, so we have time and we can stop at any moment. Stop me before you get lost, so you can continue following. Okay, so yesterday we have seen, we have started with a Puppi triangle that was indicating that the coupling constant in front of the product of two currents that were generating beta decay was approximately equal to the one ruling muon decay and approximately equal to the one ruling muon capture in nuclei. And so this suggested a universality of weak interactions for which, however, there was no basis in the sense that hadrons are very different objects with respect to leptons, and so there was no evident reason why one should find exactly the same coupling ruling all these interactions. And universality of weak interactions was put on a firm theoretical ground with the conserved vector current hypothesis of Feynman and Gell-Mann, that the hadronic part of the weak current was proportional to the strong isospin current, the raising or lowering current of strong isospin. And then these matrix elements, the matrix elements of this current, are protected by the strong isospin symmetry. So there was a symmetry argument why the matrix elements were not renormalized by strong interactions, and so why one could have universality of weak interactions. Then came strange particles with the G lambda proton approximately equal to 0.2 G muon, and also it became clear that G beta decay was significantly different from G muon, although the difference was small. And then again, one needed to find a way to reconcile these couplings and a way to guarantee that there was still a symmetry protecting the matrix elements. And this symmetry was discovered when the eightfold way was proposed. So an SU3 flavored symmetry of strong interactions, and this flavored symmetry contained not only isospin, but other two subgroups, U-spin and V-spin. Isospin has delta S equal zero, U-spin has delta Q equal zero. So this one connects, if you want, in the quark model, up and down quarks. This connects down and strange quarks. And then V-spin has delta S equal delta Q and connects U and S quarks. Okay, so Cabibbo identified the isospin current as a combination of isospin and V-spin currents with an angle theta that is the Cabibbo angle. So the projection on isospin was much larger than the projection on V-spin. And this explained why G lambda proton was much smaller than G muon, and also why G beta was not exactly identical to G mu. And there was the SU3 symmetry still protecting the matrix elements from renormalization up to the second order in SU3 breaking. Okay, so in terms of quarks, if you want, the Cabibbo current is a charged current built like that, U bar left, gamma mu cosine theta Cabibbo D left plus sine theta Cabibbo S left, which we can also write as U bar left, gamma mu D left Cabibbo. And then the effective Lagrangian, the revised Fermi Lagrangian for G Fermi over square root of 2 J mu left dagger with J mu left equal to J mu left plus J mu plus J mu Cabibbo seemed to describe very successfully all the charge current weak interactions. However, unitarity required a modification of the effective theory at an energy scale of a few hundred GeVs. And the obvious modification of this effective theory was to introduce an intermediate vector boson that could generate this current-current interaction, okay? So if you have a coupling analogous to the electromagnetic one, so a current, an intermediate vector boson, and another current, if this vector boson is massive, it's not propagating for if the available energy is much smaller than its mass, and so this interaction becomes, if this is G over square root of 2, this is the massive propagator, this is another G over square root of 2, you get that G squared over 8 mw squared, if this particle has a mass mw, is equal to G Fermi over square root of 2. So this would be a way to make the theory consistent up to higher energies. However, there were several problems still. Okay, the first problem was that if the symmetry group of weak interactions is an SU2 group, there must be the third component of the weak isospin I3 that does not coincide with electromagnetism, and I3 contains flavor change in neutral currents. Okay, so you get a term that is d barra kbbo left d kbbo left, and this contains terms that go like sine theta kbbo cosine theta kbbo s bar left d left. And even if you ignore this problem and you just do radiative corrections with the Fermi Hamiltonian, you realize that you have this kind of diagram. D left, U left, S left, U left, D left, and this mediates KK bar mixing, because it turns an S bar D state into an S D bar state. And this was not observed with rate proportional to G Fermi. Was rather observed with rate proportional to G Fermi squared M proton squared. And however, if you trust the theory up to a cutoff lambda, which should be of the order of 100 GeVs, you get that this diagram gives you G Fermi squared lambda squared, and if lambda is the scale at which the theory becomes non-unitary, this should be of order G Fermi, not of order G Fermi squared, hadronic scale squared. Now, someone asked me whether this was just being lucky, because in fact, the fact that this process arises with this at this scale depends on the fact that the top quark is almost completely decoupled from the first two generations. Okay, so as we will see later, when you go to three generations, you generalize the kbbo mixing and you have three mixing angles. Theta 1-2, that is almost equal to the kbbo angle, mixes the first two generations. Then you have theta 2-3, that mixes the second and third generation, and it's of the order of, phenomenologically, of the order of theta kbbo squared. And theta 1-3, that mixes first and third generation, is of the order of theta kbbo cubed. So the up and the charm contribution are of order theta kbbo squared, because you need twice the mixing, while to get the top in the game you have to go through the third generation, which means that so the charm up and charm have a contribution that goes like theta kbbo squared. The top gives a contribution that goes like theta kbbo to the 10th. And so it's much, much smaller. And in fact, the top gives a contribution that is of order G Fermi, because the top mass times G Fermi squared is of order, times G Fermi is of order 1. So gives exactly this kind of contribution. However, it's small accidentally because of the smallness of the mixing. So we could have been unlucky in some sense, and we could have lived in a world in which flavor change in neutral currents were not rare, and we wouldn't have been able to make this progress. But fortunately, the hierarchical structure of the CKM matrix allowed Glashow, Iliopoulos, and Maiani to apply this argument, ignoring the presence of the third generation, and to infer the presence of the charm quark. Okay? So then we have the GIM mechanism that does two things. So promotes the weak current to this form, U bar left, C bar left, cosine theta kbbo minus sine theta kbbo, cosine theta kbbo, times the left as left. Okay, this is the charged current. And now you see that the third component of the isospin is proportional to the commutator of I plus with I minus. And you see that when you work out this commutator, this turns out to be proportional to C transpose C, which is the identity in Flavor space. So there is no three-level Flavor change in neutral current coupling of the heavy gauge bosons. And the loop correction now is effectively cut off at M charm, because when the momenta P that run into this loop are much larger than MC squared, then you can neglect the mass of both the up and the charm quark, and then the unitarity of orthogonality of the Cabibbo matrix ensures that the result is zero. Okay? So the contribution from scales much larger than M charm in this loop is completely cancelled. And so the result is of order G Fermi squared MC squared, which is compatible with phenomenology. So then the idea is to build a gauge theory of weak interactions with this Flavor structure here. The only point that remains to be clarified is that this chiral weak symmetry group, SU2 left, is not comp. Yes, please.
The fact that the observed GF squared mass electron square is like, is the charm quark the cutoff that was measured?
Yes.
Okay, so it is just a coincidence that the proton mass and the.
Yes. Yes, yes. Yes, before, I mean, introducing the charm, what you verified is that the order in the weak expansion, you remember yesterday they organized the weak expansion in powers of G effective, and G effective was G Fermi lambda squared. And then these were the leading terms, and then the next two leading terms were G Fermi, but not times the cutoff, otherwise it's G effective. They put their hadronic mass, typical hadronic mass, so the proton mass squared, for example. Okay. Very good. So the problem is that SU2 left is not compatible neither with the masses of the fermions, because chiral fermions cannot get a mass, nor with the masses of the gauge bosons. And so we need to do something about the validity of the symmetry. And in fact, what I was trying to tell you yesterday, but possibly in a rather confused way, was that one can hide the symmetry in such a way that fermion masses and gauge boson masses are compatible with the symmetry requirements, although the symmetry is not evident in the spectrum, because you have massive fermions and massive gauge bosons, which is not what you expect with a gauge symmetry, and massive fermions, which is not what you expect with a chiral symmetry. Okay, so let us discuss again with a little bit less hurry spontaneous symmetry breaking, so hidden symmetries. Okay, and let us start from what happens in the standard model. So we study spontaneous symmetry breaking obtained with the vacuum expectation value of a scalar field. Okay, so if we have a theory with phi I fields, and a Lagrangian that is kinetic terms minus a potential of phi, and we have that phi minimum I is a constant field that minimizes the potential, so dv in d phi I computed at phi minimum is zero, then if we expand around the minimum, we obtain that V of phi is V of phi minimum, then the linear term is not there, and we only have the quadratic term, plus 1/2 phi I minus phi I m, phi j minus phi j m, times the second derivative of the potential with respect to phi I, phi j, computed at the minimum, plus higher orders. So the quadratic term is nothing but the mass squared of the fluctuations around the vacuum, m squared ij, is d2v over d phi a, phi I d phi j at phi minimum. And now, the invariance of the Lagrangian under a symmetry transformation for constant field becomes the invariance of the potential under a transformation. So if my Lagrangian is invariant under transformation phi I going to phi I plus alpha delta I phi with alpha very small, we obtain that V of phi I must be equal to the potential computed in the transformed fields, so V of phi I plus alpha delta I of phi, which implies that delta I of phi times the derivative of the potential with respect to phi I must be zero, since the potential is symmetric under this transformation. So if we take another derivative and go to the minimum, we obtain that zero is equal to d2, I can differentiate both terms, so zero is equal to d delta I of phi in d phi j, computed at the minimum, times delta V over delta phi I, computed at the minimum, plus delta I of phi times D2V over delta phi I, delta phi J, computed at the minimum. So I have taken another derivative and went to the minimum. At the minimum, the first derivative of the potential is zero, so this term is not there, and so this term must be zero, okay? And so this implies, since this at the minimum is nothing but the mass matrix, implies that m squared ij times delta I of phi minimum is zero. Okay, so delta I of phi minimum is an eigenvalue of the mass matrix, an eigenvector of the mass matrix with eigenvalue zero, which is a Goldstone boson. To be more explicit, we can consider a simplified version of the potential of the standard model, of the standard model X. We just take a scalar phi, and we can take the following potential, minus m squared phi star phi plus lambda phi star phi squared. And then we go to real components, so we write phi as phi 1 plus I phi 2 divided by square root of 2. You take the derivative of the potential with respect, for example, to phi 1, okay, and this is minus m squared phi 1 plus lambda phi 1 times phi 1 squared plus phi 2 squared. And there are two possibilities. One is that phi 1 is equal to 0, and the other is that phi 1 is different from 0, but phi 1 squared plus phi 2 squared are equal to m squared over lambda. You can compute the value of the potential for phi 1 equal to 0 and the value of the potential for phi 1 squared plus phi 2 squared equal to m squared over lambda, you realize that this is the true minimum. Okay, so we are in the situation that we just discussed with phi minimum equal to, so with phi minimum star phi minimum equal to m squared over 2 lambda, which I define to be v squared over 2. Okay? So v squared is nothing but m squared over lambda. This is the vacuum expectation value of the field. Of course, from the potential, I cannot compute exactly which component gets a VEV, so whether the VEV is real or not, because I have a continuum, an infinite number of vacuum that are all connected by the symmetry transformation e to the I alpha. So all the vacua are equivalent. I can choose, for example, the vacuum expectation value to be real. If I do so, then I can write that phi is equal to v over square root of 2 plus h plus I phi over square root of 2. These are the fluctuations around the vacuum. And then you can do the exercise of computing the quadratic terms, and you realize that the quadratic part of the potential is just 1 half 2m squared h squared. Phi is a massless particle that is the Goldstone boson. Okay, now what happens if I promote this symmetry to a local symmetry? So it becomes a gauge symmetry. Then I need to promote the derivative to the covariant derivative. to ensure gauge invariance. And so my new Lagrangian is the kinetic term for the U1, F mu nu, F mu nu, plus the covariant derivative d mu phi star d mu phi minus the potential, which was invariant under the global transformation, so it's still invariant also under the local one. And the covariant derivative is d mu plus I e a mu. And now this Lagrangian is invariant under local transformations, phi going to the e to the I alpha of x phi, and a mu going to a mu minus 1 over e d mu alpha of x. Now we can choose exactly the same potential, and everything goes exactly as in the global case. So H still takes a mass mh equal to square root of 2 mu square m squared. And phi is still the Goldstone boson. However, now the kinetic term is different because I also have the coupling to the gauge boson. Okay? And so d mu phi squared is 1 half d mu phi 1 squared plus 1 half d mu phi 2 squared plus e v a mu d mu phi 2 plus a mass term for the gauge boson c squared v squared over 2 a mu a mu. So, as we said yesterday, what happens is that we generate a mass term for the photon, as well as a cross term between the photon and the Goldstone boson. So this cross term here, if we treat it as an interaction, transforms the gauge boson into a Goldstone boson, okay? With an amplitude I square root of 2 E, I E V times minus I K mu, because this is just d mu phi times a mu. Okay? But EV is nothing but the gauge boson, square root of the gauge boson mass squared. So this is nothing but ma k mu. So if we treat these two quadratic terms as interactions for a second, we realize that the gauge boson propagator has the mass term, which is just here across ma squared, the insertion of the mass term. And then it has, so this is I m squared a g mu nu. And then I have the diagram in which the gauge boson converts into a would-be Goldstone boson and then turns back into a gauge boson, okay? And this is ma k mu, then the propagator of the gauge of the Goldstone boson, I over k squared, and then ma k nu. And so the resulting quadratic form is I ma squared g mu nu minus k nu over k squared. So the Goldstone boson gives you the pole. It's a pole because it would be a Goldstone boson, so it's massless. The pole needed to make the two-point function transverse with respect to the momentum. Okay, then, as we said yesterday, since a gauge transformation moves around the transforms and generates the manifold of the Goldstone bosons, now that alpha is not a global parameter, but it is a local parameter, I can use the gauge freedom to put the Goldstone boson field to zero everywhere. Okay? And this corresponds to the unitary gauge. Okay, I hope this is clearer than it was yesterday. Now, the generalization to the non-abelian case is obvious. It's just a matter of paying attention to the gauge indices. And in fact, the bulk of the argument is the same. And what one finds is that the gauge boson mass is m squared ab, now it has gauge indices, is equal to g squared ta ij phi minimum j times tb ik phi minimum k. So that if there is a combination of generators that leaves the vacuum invariant, then m squared is zero for that combination. So the symmetry is unbroken, and the gauge boson, corresponding gauge boson, remains massless. If, on the other hand, this is different from zero, then these, for each independent combination of generators that rotate the vacuum, we have a would-be Goldstone boson, and we have a massive gauge boson. Okay, and again, if you work out the kinetic term, you find a term that mixes the gauge field with the would-be Goldstone bosons, g a mu a d mu phi I Ta ij phi minimum j. And this mixing, again, as we said, is only with the Goldstone bosons. So only with the in directions that are parallel to the rotation of the vacuum. And so again, we have this term here. This vertex gives you the probability to convert gauge boson into a would-be Goldstone boson. And again, you get that the full propagator is transverse. When you add this one and this one, you get m squared ab g mu nu minus k mu k nu over k squared. Okay. Notice that, of course, this is not the only way to hide the symmetry. It's a very easy one, in the sense that you can compute everything explicitly because you have an elementary field weakly interacting that takes a vacuum expectation value. But it's not the only way, okay? There can be a complicated dynamics, maybe a strong interaction, something equivalent to QCD. In QCD, you have spontaneous breaking, dynamical breaking of SU3 left cross SU3 right to SU3 vectorial, and the gauge bosons, the Goldstone bosons, which are approximately massless because the symmetry is not exact, are the light octet of mesons. So you can break symmetry dynamically, but whatever the way in which you break symmetry, there must be a coupling of the gauge bosons to the corresponding current. And so the current has always the right quantum numbers to create a Goldstone boson from the vacuum. So FAI, different from zero for some combination of generators, implies the presence of a Goldstone boson, since current conservation requires that P squared FAI is equal to zero. In the simple case that we considered and that we will consider for the standard model, we know the explicit form of the current. J mu A is nothing but d mu phi A ta phi j. And if we insert the value of the field at the minimum, gives j mu A equal to d mu phi I TAIJ VJ, and this gives us the explicit form of FAI in this case. It's just TAIJ VJ. Okay, then the last thing that we did yesterday before closing the lecture was discussing what happens if you try to invert the gauge field propagator, because gauge invariance makes the quadratic part of the gauge kinetic term non-invertible. Because if you take the pure gauge part, minus one-fourth f mu nu, and you write explicitly the propagator by taking a Fourier transform, it has the form A mu minus k squared g mu nu plus k mu nu A nu. This is A mu of k, and this is A nu of minus k. And now, since a gauge transformation changes A mu by the derivative of the gauge parameter, so by k mu alpha, and then you immediately see that along a gauge transformation, this quadratic form is zero. So the presence of gauge invariance, under which all gauge fields connected by a gauge transformation are equivalent, doesn't allow you to invert the quadratic form of the gauge field, the quadratic part of the gauge field kinetic term, and so doesn't allow you to write a propagator. And so we need to fix the gauge. A proper way to do it is by introducing the functional integral and do the Faddeev-Popov trick, etc., etc. But we don't have time to go through all that, so yesterday we have just written down what happens if you add the suitable gauge fixing term. And the suitable gauge fixing term that one adds when there is a spontaneous symmetry breaking for the gauge symmetry is exactly to cancel this mixing here, which is a bit annoying when you work out the propagator. And so this decouples the propagation of the gauge boson from the would-be Goldstone boson at the price of giving a gauge-dependent mass to the Goldstone boson. Okay? So we have written yesterday the form of the propagators in a generic renormalizable gauge. So for the gauge field A mu, the propagator becomes minus I over K squared minus M A squared times G mu nu minus K mu K nu over K squared minus Xi M A squared times the gauge parameter 1 minus Xi. And then the propagator of the Goldstone boson becomes I over K squared minus Xi MA squared. When you do things properly, you realize you also have to add ghosts, and they also get a mass that depends on the gauge parameter, but we don't have time to discuss that. So the unitary gauge corresponds to the Xi going to infinity limit. Okay? In that case, the mass of the would-be Goldstone boson, the gauge-dependent mass, goes to infinity, so it doesn't propagate anymore, it's out of the game. And this is exactly what we have seen, that you can make it zero everywhere by a suitable gauge transformation. So this suitable gauge transformation is equivalent to a gauge fixing with Xi going to infinity. So Phi doesn't appear anymore. And then, if you take the Xi going to infinity limit, you go back to the propagator with K mu, K nu over MA squared here, which is the unitary gauge propagator, which, however, is not the best option if you want to study radiative corrections, because this propagator here, this term here, when k squared goes to infinity, grows like k squared, and so the full propagator doesn't vanish as 1 over k squared. And so this makes identifying the divergent terms very difficult, and so it is often inconvenient when one wants to study radiative corrections. Rather, one can choose a finite value of Xi Okay? The most popular choices are the Feynman gauge, in which xi is equal to zero. So I over k squared is the propagator of the Goldstone boson, and the propagator of the gauge boson is proportional to g mu nu. This is the Lorentz minus k mu k nu over k squared. This is the Lorentz gauge. And the Feynman gauge instead is xi equal 1, so the gauge boson propagator is just minus I g mu nu over k squared minus ma squared, and the Goldstone boson propagator is I over k squared minus ma squared. The gauge symmetry that you still have ensures that physical results do not depend on the choice of xi. You can verify this explicitly by studying gauge boson exchange between two fermionic currents. And you realize that current conservation that is connected to the symmetry makes xi dependent terms to cancel when you add up gauge bosons and would-be Goldstone bosons. Okay? So the cancellation is between those two contributions. But we don't have time to see this explicitly here. Okay, so finally we are ready to study the standard model case, which is only slightly more complicated because in the standard model, the massless eigenvector, so the generators that leave the vacuum invariant, do not belong to one simple group, but are a combination of two groups, SU2 left and hypercharge. Okay, so I leave it as an exercise to write down the explicit form of the TAs for SU2 left and for the electromagnetic current, and to identify the generators of the hypercharge in such a way that Q on the vacuum is zero. So in such a way that Ty plus T3 on phi m is zero. This identifies the hypercharge, and then the corresponding massless gauge boson is the eigenvector of the mass squared for the gauge bosons corresponding to this combination. So in the basis W1 mu, W2 mu, W3 mu, and B mu, where B mu is the gauge boson connected to hypercharge. Then the eigenvector with eigenvalue 0 is just 0, 0, 1 over g, 1 over g prime, where g is the gauge coupling of SU2 left, and g prime is the gauge coupling of U1 hypercharge. It's an easy exercise. You write down the explicit form of the transformations using real fields, and you find this combination here. Okay, so maybe it's a good moment to go for coffee, and we reconvene in 15 minutes, unless you have questions. Please.
The general philosophy in the end will be to forget completely about the laws and models, right, and just to update the game model. What I'm used to, like, how to get them.
Yes, this is sounds great. However, it's not so great from the computational point of view, because as I said, the ultraviolet behavior of the gauge boson propagator, when you forget about the Goldstone bosons, is not good. So if you want to prove the renormalizability of the standard model, and if you want to have to avoid the spurious divergences, you normally prefer to use a renormalizable gauge in which you keep the would-be Goldstone bosons. Okay? The result will not depend on your choice, but technically is much more convenient because everything behaves properly, and so you can just, with standard techniques, evaluate your virtual corrections. Okay. Other doubts? Please.
This integration of the value of the state that minimizes the potential, it seems classical. Does it change?
Ah, yes, that's a very good question. That's a very good question. Thanks. I've been doing classical things without explicitly saying it, okay? So when you go to the quantum case, there are three main points, okay? The first point is that you have to verify that your symmetry survives at the quantum level. What can happen? The problem is that when you do higher orders in perturbation theory, you have loops, you have divergences, and you have to regularize your theory. Otherwise, you cannot compute anything, and you cannot remove the divergences. It can happen sometimes that there is no way to regularize the theory preserving the symmetry. Okay? In this case, the symmetry is called anomalous. And the anomaly gives you an extra term in the current conservation equation, which breaks the symmetry. So for global symmetries, this is fine, because if the global symmetry is broken by the anomaly, you just have to take the anomaly into account when you compute the phenomenology. For example, the axial U1 symmetry of strong interactions has an anomaly which explains why the eta prime meson is much heavier than the octet ones. Okay.
If, however, the symmetry is gauged, then there is the problem, because you cannot live with a broken gauge symmetry. So either you give up the symmetry, and so you throw away your model, or you give up renormalizability, and you add a counter term that is non-renormalizable that cancels the anomaly. This could be done, for example, if your complete model contains some very heavy particle that you integrate away. For example, in the standard model, if you want to remove the top, and then since the standard model has a chiral gauge group and the anomalies are canceled by the different contribution of each family, if you remove just one quark, you get an anomaly. But then there is no problem, because you know that this is an effective theory and the full theory doesn't have the anomaly. So, provided that you can regularize your theory in such a way that the symmetry is preserved, so provided that there is no anomaly, then you can carry out all the discussion that I carried out here by replacing the potential with the effective potential, which can be computed in a loop expansion. Okay, so you can show that the effective potential plays exactly the same role of the classical one. And in fact, you can trigger symmetry breaking by using the effective potential. So you can have loop corrections that generate a potential that breaks the symmetry. And in fact, now probably nobody studies supersymmetric phenomenology anymore, but if some of you open, for example, the classic, I think it's in the Nilles physics report on supersymmetric models, there is an interesting part about radiative electroweak symmetry breaking, in which he writes, you realize that in this supersymmetric model, you can radiatively break the electroweak symmetry thanks to the top contribution. However, he says, this requires mTOP of the order of 180 GV, which sounds absurd, because at the time, of course, one was living at a few GVs, so nobody imagined that the top was really that heavy. But in fact, for physical values, or current values of the top quark mass, it's not impossible, for example, to generate radiative electroweak symmetry breaking in supersymmetric, in the minimal supersymmetric standard model. So the answer is, this discussion holds, however, you have to take into account the radiative corrections to the potential, which can be done with standard techniques for loop calculations. Another problem at the quantum level is, as I said, the presence of ghosts, which are needed to ensure unitarity. But again, we don't have time to discuss this here. Okay, so if there are no more questions, we go for coffee and we start again at 20 past 11. Okay, so for the moment, but we will come back to it very shortly, let me skip the argument why we need, in the standard model, three generations. We'll come back very shortly. And so let me now define, finally, the standard model as the most general renormalizable Lagrangian that one can write assuming the following gauge group, SU3 color, times SU2 left times U1 hypercharge with three generations of quarks and leptons and the following representations for fermions. Okay, so we have three generations of left-handed quark doublets. Whose quantum numbers are, these are triplets of SU3 doublets of SU2 and have hypercharge 1/6. Then we have, for this left-handed doublet, we have two right-handed singlets, U, I, R, which is a 3, 1/2, DIR, that is 3, 1, -1/3. Those are SU2 singlets, so the hypercharge coincides with the charge. And then we have a doublet of leptons, so three doublets of leptons, Li equal to nu I E I left, with that are singlets under color, doublets under SU2 with hypercharge -1/2. And finally, right-handed charged leptons that are singlets under SU3, singlets under SU2, and have hypercharge -1. We have three of them, and at this stage, we say that these three generations are defined up to the mass terms that will be introduced, that will define a specific orientation in flavor space. So, requiring the gauge symmetry and the field content for the fermions fixes the first part of the Lagrangian, that would be L gauge, pure gauge, plus the kinetic terms for the fermions, psi bar / psi, sum over all these representations with the appropriate covariant derivative. And then we need to break the symmetry, and we will use a Higgs doublet with the potential that we have just studied previously. So V of phi will be minus mu squared phi dagger phi plus lambda phi dagger phi squared. With phi, equal to phi plus phi zero, so a doublet, a singlet under SU3, a doublet under SU2 with hypercharge 1/2. Now, the strength of the standard model is in the fact that with the Higgs mechanism, not only we give mass to the gauge bosons, but we can also, at the same time, give mass to the fermions. With the Yukawa Lagrangian, there is YU IJ Q bar left I in addition to phi, since SU2 is a pseudo-real pseudo-real representations, I can have an independent, sorry, not an independent, I can build a doublet with the opposite hypercharge that I call phi tilde, that is just I sigma 2 phi star. This is always a doublet of SU2, but has hypercharge minus 1 half. And I need both of them to give masses to up and down type quarks. So the up masses involve phi tilde. So phi tilde u r j. Then I have plus yd ij q bar left I phi drj plus ye ij l bar left I phi erj. The Yukawa Lagrangian is universally known to be the worst part of the standard model because it's, I mean, doesn't arise from any gauge symmetry principle. And it has basically the two tasks. The first task is to give mass to the fermions. And the second task is to break a huge accidental symmetry of the standard model. Because in fact, if you look at the gauge part, you realize that the gauge part is invariant under global transformations of U3 Q left times U3 U right times U3 D right times U3 L left times U3 E right. If you want, this is what the G mechanism is based on. The fact that the gauge interactions are flavor blind. And so the gauge part of the Lagrangian has a huge global symmetry that is completely accidental. What do I mean by accidental symmetry? An accidental symmetry is defined by the fact that if you have the most general Lagrangian invariant under some symmetry principle and with specified field content and the requirement of renormalizability, it could be that this most general Lagrangian is invariant under some additional symmetry group that is not the one that you imposed at the beginning. Okay? For example, in the standard model, the gauge part, if the fermions were massless, the gauge part would have this huge flavored symmetry that would be completely accidental. Okay? Now, the Yukawa couplings break this accidental symmetry, and they also have the task to generate CP violation in weak interactions. In fact, if I look at the Yukawa couplings and I implement a CP transformation, I see that for example, why? So to implement a CP transformation, you have to do the following. Under CP, psi goes into gamma zero, a matrix that is the charge conjugation matrix that you have to introduce because you have Dirac indices, times psi bar transposed. And psi bar goes to psi transposed C gamma zero. And phi goes to phi star. Now, if you work out, for example, the transformation of the down type Yukawa couplings, you get that yd ij q bar left I phi drj goes to d bar right j h dagger q left I times yd ij. Because of course you are not touching this matrix here. Psi goes into gamma zero, C psi bar transposed.
And the other one is psi bar, probably.
Sorry, okay. Yes.
Also, assuming the H, the second, the right hand side of the last equation should be a phi.
Yes, sorry. Sorry. Phi dagger. So this would be the Hermitian conjugate of this. However, why? Is not conjugated, okay? So this would take this term to the Hermitian conjugate, which would imply CP invariance of the Lagrangian, if ydij is real. So CP invariance of the standard model Lagrangian requires real Yukawa couplings. And now the question is, how many physical parameters do we have in the Yukawa couplings? Because we have to remember that the rest of the Lagrangian has this accidental symmetry. Okay? And when you break an accidental symmetry, there is a rule that tells you that you can remove a parameter from the breaking terms for each generator that you are breaking. Okay? This is very simple because if here you are breaking by introducing the Yukawa couplings, and then since the rest of the Lagrangian is invariant under this transformation, you can apply this transformation to the Yukawa couplings. Nothing will change in the rest of the Lagrangian, but the Yukawa couplings will be rotated. So you can use the symmetries that you are breaking by adding the Yukawa couplings to remove physical parameters from the Yukawa couplings. Okay? And in fact, the Yukawa couplings are 9x9 complex matrices, so they are parameterized by 9 real parameters and 9 phases. So the Yukawa Lagrangian for the quarks contains 18 real parameters plus 18 phases. Now, a U3 transformation has 3 squared parameters, 3 times 3 minus 1 divided by 2 are the angles, so 3 angles, and 6 phases. So we have 3 of them. We have U3, Q left, D right, and U right. So we can remove 9 real parameters and 18 phases. However, this is not completely true, because the Yukawa couplings, the quark-Yukawa couplings, are still invariant under a global symmetry, that is baryon number conservation. Okay? These couplings here preserve a global U1, that is U1 baryon number. So this, since this is unbroken, we cannot remove from the Yukawa couplings the phase corresponding to this unbroken symmetry, just because this U1 baryon transformation doesn't touch the Yukawa couplings. So we cannot remove 18 phases, but we can remove only 17. So we have 18 minus 9 equal to 9 real parameters. Which we can identify with 6 masses, the masses of the up type and down type quarks, and 3 mixing angles. And we have 18 minus 17, 1 phase left. And this single phase is responsible for all CP violating processes that you see in weak interactions. Okay, so it's a very constrained system. Any observable in CP violation in weak interactions must depend on this phase only. If we had only 2 generations, and we repeated the counting, we would realize that we can remove all the phases. Okay? So there will be only 4 masses and 1 angle. That's it. And in fact, we know that with 2 families only, we have the Kabibbo angle and the quark masses and nothing more. Okay? So since CP violation in KK bar mixing was observed back in the 60s, it was clear that one had to go beyond the Kabibbo theory to accommodate CP violation. And then there is the fundamental paper by Kobayashi and Maskawa where they show that with 3 generations you can you can have CP violation. Unfortunately, they were awarded the Nobel Prize without Kabibbo, but it's clear that without Kabibbo, they wouldn't have any idea of mixing matrices. But okay, certainly they deserved it. Good. So, in the end, when we go to the mass eigenstate basis for quarks, we will be left with quark masses, 3 mixing angle, and 1 phase. We can do this explicitly, and you can do it as an exercise, by noticing that you can diagonalize, you can take the Yukawa couplings for the quarks, YU, IJ, Q bar left, phi tilde U right J, QLI, plus YD IJ Q q bar left I phi d right j. You give a vacuum expectation value to the Higgs field that is 1 over square root of 2, 0, v. And from those couplings, you get masses. M fermion ij is equal to v over square root of 2, y fermion ij. Now this is a complex matrix, and you can diagonalize it with a b-unitary transformation. So you find the left-handed matrix by imposing that you left dagger m dagger you left is equal to m squared. There is a diagonal matrix that has on the diagonal the three masses. M1 squared, M2 squared, M3 squared. And then you define the right-handed rotation matrix by diagonalizing in the same way the other combination, M dagger M, you write, which is still equal to M squared. Since M dagger and M dagger M are emission matrices, they can be diagonalized with a unitary matrix. Then these unitary matrices, in fact, can sit in this more general symmetry. For the right-handed rotations, we have a right-handed U3 independently for up-type quarks and down-type quarks. So this tells us that when we apply this transformation, and we go to the mass eigenstate basis by saying that u left dagger m u right is equal to diagonal m1, m2, m3, and you can check explicitly that this works. This is called the singular value decomposition of the matrix M. And of course you have m up and M down, and the right-handed rotations will be U upright and U downright. U upright and U downright are 3x3 unitary matrices, and they sit in this global symmetry, U3, U right, U3, D right, of the rest of the Lagrangian. So they disappear completely from the Lagrangian. You go to the mass eigenstate basis, this U right matrices disappear. For the left-handed rotations, there is a problem, however, because we only have one U 3Q left, but we have to do two different transformations. We have U left and a U D left. We need two of them, two independent rotations, to go to the mass eigenstate basis. Okay? So this means that these matrices will not cancel completely. However, thanks to the Gym mechanism, the neutral currents only couple down quarks to down quarks and up quarks to up quarks. Otherwise, we will break charge conservation. So neutral currents will always feature either you left dagger you left, sorry, you up left dagger you up left, or you down left dagger you down left. And both of these will be the identity matrix. So the rotation matrices cancel out completely in neutral currents. The only place where they survive are the charged currents. Because there, the charged current is of the form u bar left I gamma mu d left I. And now when we apply this rotation, this becomes u bar left v c k m gamma mu d left. And v c k m is just, let me try to put the dagger at the right place. V is just u u l dagger u d l. So of all these rotations, the only one that matter is the relative orientation of u left and d left. So the relative left-handed rotation between the masses of the out-type quarks and the masses of the down-type quarks. If you want, the CKM, this relative rotation identifies exactly the mismatch between the weak isospin in the strong interaction SU3, because the strangeness is defined by masses. Okay, we define a strange particle because of its mass. It's a mass eigenstate. So it's defined by the mass, while the weak isospin is defined by the gauge current. And the mismatch between the two is what defines not only the Kabibbo angle, but the whole Kabibbo Kobayashi Maskawa matrix. And the CKM matrix is characterized by three angles, theta 1, 2, that is almost equal to the Kabibbo angle, theta 2, 3, and theta 1, 3, and one phase, let me call it delta. This phase doesn't have a specified position in the CKM matrix, because since we can remove all phases except for one, the way in which we remove it moves around the phase in the CKM matrix. But this doesn't matter, because finally the result, of course, will not depend on the phase convention that you choose. However, you have to be careful not to mix different phase conventions when you do a calculation, as always. Okay, so having said that, we can finally arrive to the structure of weak interactions in the standard model. So the gauge boson masses come from the kinetic term, as we have seen already. And we have identified also the eigenstate corresponding to the photon. So if we write down explicitly the quadratic term for the gauge bosons, it has the following form. It's 1/2 v squared over 4 g squared w mu 1 plus g squared w mu 2 plus g squared w mu 3 plus g primed b mu squared . And then there is a cross term, minus 2 gg prime w mu 3 b mu. And so we can rewrite this as 1/2 v squared over 4, g squared w mu 1 w mu 1 plus g squared w mu 2 w mu 2 plus minus g a mu 3, w mu 3 plus g prime b mu squared. So the combination orthogonal to this one is the photon, and it remains massless. And this one gets a mass, as the other two components here, proportional to the vacuum expectation value. So we can identify W mu plus and minus as 1 over square root of 2, W mu 1 minus plus I W mu 2. And they have a mass MW equal to G V over 2. And then z mu is identified with 1 over square root of g squared plus g prime squared. G a mu 3, w mu 3, sorry, minus g prime b mu. And this has a mass mz equal to square root of g squared plus g prime squared v over 2. And the fourth vector that is orthogonal to z mu is the photon m mu, which is just 1 over square root of g squared plus g prime squared, g prime w mu 3 plus g b mu. Here g is the SU3 coupling and g prime is the hypercharge coupling, and MA is equal to 0. You can check that this corresponds to the combination of couplings that we found before. So we can define the weak mix in angle. So we write Z0 and A as cosine theta weak minus sine theta weak sine theta weak cosine theta weak times W3 MB. Which corresponds to sine theta equal to g prime over square root of g squared plus g prime squared, cosine theta equal to g over square root of g squared plus g prime squared, and the electric charge is E is g sine theta w, or g prime cosine theta w. Using these fields, we can rewrite the covariant derivative d mu as d mu minus e g over square root of 2 w mu plus T plus plus W mu minus T minus, where T plus and T minus are the raising and lowering operator of weak isospin, minus I G over cosine theta W Z mu T3 minus sine squared theta weak Q minus I E A mu Q. So this allows us to read immediately the couplings of all the standard model fermions according to their quantum numbers under weak isospin and charge. And we have the following relation for the gauge boson masses. That is a very important one. You see that Mw, we can eliminate V over 2 from Mw and Mz, and we obtain that Mw is equal to Mz cosine theta weak. So we can define rho equal to, by definition, Mw squared over Mz squared cos squared theta W. And at the three level in the standard model, this is one. This is a very important result from the phenomenological point of view, because it corresponds to another accidental symmetry of the standard model. Okay, give me just 2 minutes to discuss this accidental symmetry, if I find it. If not, we do it even more, okay. Provided I find it. Otherwise, I will be wrong for sure. Ah, here it is, sorry. So, let us go back for a second to the Higgs potential. From the Higgs potential, we see the relation essentially comes, that relation, essentially comes from the fact that these three terms, W1, W2, and W3, get the same mass. Because then, when you build this combination, automatically you get cosine theta W here. Okay, because here you have G, and here you have this combination of G and G prime, and this combination is the one that defines the cosine theta. Okay, so any potential that ensures that the three components of W's get the same mass will give the same result. And in fact, this is connected to a symmetry of the potential. There is another very important accidental symmetry of the potential, of the Higgs potential in the standard model. In fact, in the absence of hypercharge, this would turn into Mw equal to Mz, okay? So, the Higgs potential, it's of the form, it's a function of phi dagger phi in the standard model. But now, phi dagger phi, you can write it in real components, is 5-1 squared plus 5-2 squared plus 5-3 squared plus 5-4 squared, where if you write phi as phi 1 plus I phi 2 phi 3 plus I phi 4 divided by square root of 2. Okay? So the potential of the standard model is invariant under this O4 symmetry, actually probably SO4. And this SO4 symmetry, you can also write it as an SU2 cross SU2 symmetry by defining capital phi as the product of phi tilde and phi. Okay? It's a 2x2 matrix. And now, if you take the trace of phi dagger phi, this is equal to twice phi, not capital dagger phi, sorry for the poor notation. And so you can write the potential as a function of trace of capital phi dagger capital phi. And now, clearly, the trace of phi capital dagger phi is invariant under phi going to UL phi UR dagger. With these two arbitrary and independent unitary matrices. The covariant kinetic term for phi if we switch off hypercharge is d mu minus I g w mu I sigma I over 2, sigma are the Pauli matrices, times phi squared. And this still has the full SU2 cross SU2 invariance. When phi gets a VEV, the capital phi gets a VEV that is diagonal, okay, because phi tilde has the neutral component up, and phi has the neutral component down. And so the VEV is just V over square root of 2 times the identity matrix. So since the VEV is proportional to the identity matrix, this breaks SU2 left cross SU2 right to SU2 diagonal. And also the mass terms must be invariant under the residual SU2. And this guarantees that the mass of the W's has the form sum over I W mu I W mu I. And this in turn guarantees this relation here. So this prediction that at the tree level rho is equal to 1 holds because of this accidental symmetry of the Higgs potential. And so it remains true whatever form of the potential you choose, provided that it's invariant under this custodial symmetry, so-called custodial symmetry. So for example, you can add an arbitrary number of doublets. Still, the potential will be invariant under the custodial SU2. However, if, for example, you add the triplet, then the triplet is not invariant under the custodial SU2, and so if you add the Higgs triplet, then this relation is violated at the tree level. But provided you give a potential that is invariant under custodial symmetry, this three-level relation will continue to remain true. And since phenomenologically it's very successful, it's important to keep it. However, this custodial symmetry is broken in the standard model once you consider the Yukawa couplings. Okay? Because to write the Yukawa couplings in an SU2 left cross SU2 right symmetric form, you would need to promote the right-handed quarks to an SU2 right doublet. So you would need to write the Yukawa couplings as Q bar left capital phi Q right with Q right equal to U right D right. Okay? You can do it. However, the Yukawa matrix is not diagonal in this space. It's not the identity in this space. So the Yukawa couplings become YU, YD. And you see, therefore, that the largest breaking of the custodial symmetry in the standard model comes from the top quark Yukawa coupling, which is much larger than all the other ones. Okay? If the Yukawa couplings were be equal, the custodial symmetry wouldn't be violated. Okay? This is very similar to what you have what we have seen in the Gym mechanism, no? If the masses of the up and charm quarks were equal, the result of that loop would be exactly zero. And here, the results of the radiative corrections to rho equal one due to the Yukawa couplings would be zero if the up-type quarks were degenerate with the corresponding down-type quarks. And so, just as in the Gym mechanism, we expected a correction of order G Fermi MC squared. Here, we can expect a radiative correction to this relation of order G Fermi MT squared, which is large. So we expect that the top will be the will give the dominant radiative correction to this relation here. But I think we can stop now, and tomorrow we will start discussing observables connected. So we start discussing precision observables in the electroweak sector, and then directly, but at least discuss how to compute radiative corrections and how to test them experimentally. Now, just to understand for the next lectures, are all of you familiar with the normalization of the standard model? So, okay. Who's familiar with the normalization group equations? Okay. Half of the people. I cannot obviously do everything, but I will try to make it as accessible as possible. Thank you very much.